I think as a teacher and then also just as a general citizen of South Africa, I think it's so important to equip our kids, you know, with these skills. And so when I look back at, you know, my high school career, I wish I took these things more seriously. Yeah. But at the same time, I guess that is where we also see the gap in our education system, where we are not empowering our kids to you know, make purchases on homes and things like that.
Good evening and welcome back to the First Time Homebuyer Show. I'm your host, SD Klaassen. I have exciting news for you, but before I get to that, as you know, Private Property brings you amazing content every night this week. We have Zamantungwa Kumalo with the Private Property Podcast. That's Monday to Friday at 7 p.m. Amazing guests coming to you, talking technicalities, what it is that you need to apply for a home loan. All the questions you have, we answer them right there. And exciting news, Chad Viveros with the Home Shopper Show every Monday and Friday night at 8 p.m. Chad Viveros has just been around Cape Town. I'm talking Paarl, Franschhoek, Camps Bay, Clifton, everything you need to see right there on the Home Shopper Show. And last but not least, the Farming Podcast, everything you need to know about agriculture. Do you have those green fingers? Well, Mbali comes to you every Tuesday and Thursday at 8 p.m. And tonight, I'm sitting with the absolutely amazing Sherith Whaley, correct?
Absolutely.
Absolutely correct. I got it right this time. Sherith Whaley, all the way from Cape Town. We're sitting on this amazing wine farm, Saxonburg. On your way to Stellenbosch, do pop in here. Absolutely amazing. The food is great. The wine is great. And tonight we're talking about how Sherith went on her journey to buy her first home. Everything, the mistakes she made, the lessons she learned, everything she went through, the ups and the downs. All the information you need right here. Good evening, Sherith. How are you?
Good evening, everybody. Thank you so much for having me. I'm doing well. How are you?
I can't complain. Thank you so much for coming on the show. I mean, as you know, you've watched all of our shows, that Private Property show. You know, I mean, from farming you spoke about to the Home Shopper to the normal podcast. And this is a question I've never asked, but I feel like I need to ask you this question because I feel like we're in a very similar boat.
Right.
What is Sherith passionate about?
Good question. I think there's so many variables to that answer. But I think what really is the foundation of that is I'm very passionate about people.
Mm.
And I consider myself to be a people's person. So I enjoy interacting with people, I enjoy engaging with people. And that is why I'm actually a teacher, because I get to interact with people on a daily basis. I enjoy, you know, being involved in youth groups and meeting new people. So yeah, I think my life is just revolved around individuals.
People and helping people,
right.
You know. And, you know, especially when it comes to the youth. And I'm so passionate about helping the youth as well. And we were talking a lot before the show about you, a business owner.
Right.
As well, you forgot that part, Sherith. Let's tell them about that.
It's quite a journey. So yes, I started a small company or small business rather, called Pink Cinnamon. And that I actually happened to start in lockdown. So that happened to be, I think, July, when we just about entered into lockdown. And I thought, well, why not just start up something? So I started going onto Facebook, I started up a page. And I kind of love anything to do with accessories. I love style, I love fashion. Particularly my field or in my life at the moment, my schedule is quite hectic. So I'm always looking for things that would work for me style-wise, you know, working with a busy schedule. So I found little things that would help, things like scrunchies and slides and headbands and those types of things. So
right.
I thought, why not start up something like that?
And how was that journey for you, like just to start? Because as you know, we talk to a lot of young people
right.
on the show, and I'm sure all of them, you know, want to take that leap of faith.
Mm.
You're a full-time teacher. You started a company. You bought a home. I mean, Sherith, what did you not do? What did you not do? So yeah, Sherith, what was that like for you, you know, starting a business, especially during a pandemic?
Well, I think, I mean, you asked me earlier, you know, there's a lot of young people who would like to, you know, start up a business and so on. I don't think my journey was any different, or the feelings behind it was any different compared to someone else. I mean, there's always that fear of having to put yourself out there, you know, not knowing if people are going to support, not knowing if what you're going to sell is actually going to sell, because the point of it is actually to make money. I've had that same insecurities, I've had that same fears. But I think one of the things that I've learned very early on as a young person is to literally just take the shot in the dark. No one can kind of pin you, you know, against the wall for not trying. And that's what I did. It's still definitely a slow progress, but slow progress is still progress nonetheless.
100%.
So it's a good journey. I've received a lot of support. What I can say is also that I've discovered that sometimes, you know, family and friends won't always support what you're going after. And I think that has been one of the most interesting things that I've actually come to learn about that. Mm. And I think that's something that young people are constantly bringing to the forefront in conversations, where we talk about how family and friends are not supporting one another when it comes to, you know, it's funny because you'll find support from people who don't know you.
That's
so
very true.
That's definitely something that I've kind of picked
from
up
strangers.
On.
So yeah, that's very yeah. true. And you know what's so important about the show, and what's been kind of like a repetitive topic of discussion, right, when I talk to property investors, mm-hmm. property moguls, first-time homebuyers, they often talk about having a very good support structure. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure when you have bought your first home, not just your business, but right. taking that, again, it's another leap of faith. Mm-hmm. Buying your first home, again, you needed that support structure. But just before we talk about, you know, investing, your property investing journey, you are still a student. You're doing your honors.
I am.
And you're working.
Yes.
And you bought a home.
Yes.
Like the list is, it just goes on. And I wanted to talk about that because you spoke about having a really good support structure.
Right.
You spoke about progress. Slow progress is progress.
Right.
How do you juggle all of these things?
I don't.
Oh, okay.
I just take the leap of faith. Mm. And I take it as it comes.
Yeah.
There's really no other answer I can give you. There are times where I feel very, very overwhelmed. There are times I get home and I just feel so drained and exhausted. I even think that as I'm sitting here right now, my body even feels run down.
Right.
But like I said to you, take it as it comes and you do your best.
Mm. And we spoke in depth about taking that leap of faith, but like I'd like you to continue about, like I said, you have a busy schedule. We've heard about the load you're carrying. Mm. And working with kids is not easy.
Oh, definitely not.
Let me tell you that.
Yeah. Well, I think what really works in my favor is that I'm always scheduling things. So, you know, I obviously sit with a daily planner and I schedule, okay, you know, on this day I've got X, Y, and Z. For this week, this is due. My kids are writing exams at the moment, so I've got to be able to make sure that my exam papers are set up. Next week, I've got a business appointment. This week, I've got to, you know, be with you. So what really helps me is time management skills. But obviously with time management skills, you know, things, you know, don't
life
always,
happens.
Life happens.
Yeah.
So some things are unplanned, and sometimes you just gotta roll with the punches. And that's basically my philosophy, is just to roll with the punches, to be honest with you.
I just want to say something. I haven't had a female on the show, so thank
wow.
you so much.
That's
because
amazing.
Yeah. And on that note, like, let's talk about, you know, like, women in property.
Wow.
Firstly, let me give you some stats. You know, I think about last year, they spoke about how young, single women of color are taking over the property market. And here you are, a young colored woman in Cape Town, and you're just, you know, you're taking over. And I feel like, tell me what that felt like for you when you signed that OTP, when you held the keys in your hand.
Well, I think being able to kind of just, you know, sign in the dotted line and say that this is now officially my home, it held such importance for so many reasons. One of them being, you know, as an only daughter, I was actually able to buy a house that would, you know, house my parents as well. So it's the three of us in the home at the moment. Mm-hmm. And so for me to be able to do that, being the first grandchild, being the first child in my family to be able to buy a house on her own, you know, that speaks so much volume into, to, you know, the situation itself. But then also the capacity that the women in my family actually have. And so I hope that when I have a daughter one day, you know, that she would be able to do the same thing. So it becomes a generational thing. And on that note, I also want to speak about generational curses as young people that we are facing at the moment. And so we are dealing with that, where we deal with the issue of black tax, and we are dealing with, you know, having to break those generational curses.
100%.
So as I sit here, I sit as a testimony of how broken that generational curse.
100%.
And so when I have my own kids, they can only do one thing but to follow in those two footsteps.
Right.
And then also, I think as a woman, I mean, come on, I'm 24. I bought this house on the verge of being 24. It officially became my house just as I, you know, just entered into to my birthday. And so I think that is just, as a young person, as a woman, I feel so empowered. I feel like nothing can stop me, you know. So I feel like if I can buy a house at this young age, what can I do when I'm, you know, 40?
When you're my age, you know, when she's my age, because I mean, hello. I mean, that's amazing.
Right.
That's absolutely, and I love that, you know, you just dropped the bomb and said that you're 24. But I love that, you know, you're young, you're right. You're still studying, you're still, and this is something that you, it's something you can also, when you're gone, leave for your parents, you know, or something, and you're right, you're breaking a generational curse. Mm-hmm. You're breaking your daughter, your son even.
Right.
You know, I know we were on the topic of women in power and stuff, but you know, the men as well, you're leaving this legacy.
Right.
And that's very important, it's the legacy. So I know we're talking about property, but you brought all these questions into what legacy does Shereth want to leave?
Good question. Integrity we kind of define as, you know, doing the right thing when no one's looking. And I think what's really important is that I want to be able to leave a legacy where my children understand that whatever they do, you know, they do the right thing. And I think as a young person, I'm also learning to kind of on that journey, always, you know, to kind of do the right thing. And sometimes doing the right thing isn't always the easiest thing.
100%.
I think one of the other things in terms of legacy I would love to leave is the importance of financial stability.
Mm.
And on that, when I grew up, you know, people have this perception, you know, that I had an easy, you know, childhood, that everything was kind of handed over to me. And especially when people hear that I'm the only daughter, the only child, people tend to have a certain perception that I was kind of spoiled, and that couldn't be further from the truth.
Right.
You know, there was a time where I slept on boxes when I was younger. There was a time where myself and my parents shared one room together. Mm. There was a time where we had no food at home. And so one of the ways in which I am trying to break that as a generational curse is by now already starting financial stability.
Mm.
So that is why that is so important to me as well. And it doesn't come from a place of, you know, never wanting to face the fact that sometimes life just happens to people, and that is so true.
Mm.
But at the same time, it's also about them taking responsibility of their finances, which includes their property, which includes, you know,
other investments.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And I think that's part of the legacy. I think also kindness, that is something that's very important to me, you know. Being mindful, you know, of other people, being considerate. Those things are really important to
listen,
me.
Listen, you are speaking my language.
Yeah.
Mindfulness is so important. And, oh, wow, I'm going to get vulnerable again. Every week I must cry on the show. It's not okay. So, you know, I want to go back to, like, our parents, you know, back in the day, and how our parents, it's not that they didn't teach us how to save. But I feel like there wasn't enough room or enough education, even from their parents, that led us and that we could be educated on financial literacy at home.
Right.
The only education we had about financial literacy was at school.
Mm.
And that also is not enough.
Right.
So let's talk about this. You talk about financial stability and breaking these curses. And you speak so passionately about this because to me it sounds like to break these curses, the most important thing is to be financially stable and literate.
Right.
And you know, I was reading an article, I mentioned this in one of my shows, is that yes, coronavirus is a pandemic, but financial illiteracy is another pandemic.
Right.
The youth are illiterate when it comes to financial stability. We don't know how. We're not getting enough education, and that is why we have platforms like this, because there are people, young adults like the two of us, who are currently sitting in the state of how do we save? Mm. So let's talk about you, Shereth. How did you plan on saving up for your first home?
Okay, when it comes to the savings, specifically when it comes to the house, there was no plan. There really was no plan. When I decided to actually purchase the home, what had happened was I was renting before.
Uh-huh.
And the place that I was renting at, I won't give figures, but it was basically more than 10K.
Mm-hmm.
And I couldn't see how I could spend all this money on, you know, paying this rent when I could literally buy a home.
Yeah.
And the bond was lower than the rent.
Right.
So it came to a point where I just felt like I could not spend this money any further. This is money that could go towards something else. And so I began just thinking about it and thinking about it. And then I started just starting my journey with, you know, wanting to purchase a home. And so what I did was I put a bit of money away, and then I just basically used the deposit that I put down for the rental,
mm-hmm.
and I used that towards the transfer fees. So
right.
that was kind of part of my savings plan, but there was no set time when I said, okay, you know, I aim to buy a house within the next year, I'm going to put money, you know, forward. I think in my journey, That was a mistake that I actually made. Mm-hmm. And that is something that when I reflect on my journey, I wish I had done that. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so as you were saying, you know, you were speaking about financial literacy and how important it is to actually empower our kids with these skills. I think as a teacher and then also just as a general citizen of South Africa, I think it's so important to equip our kids, you know, with these skills. And so when I look back at, you know, my high school career, I wish I took these things more seriously. Yeah. But at the same time, I guess that is where we also see the gap in our education system, where we are not empowering our kids to you know, make purchases on homes and things like that.
I want to talk, I'm going to put you on the spot a little bit here now, right?
Okay.
You're a teacher, you're an educator, you're a facilitator,
right.
You're guiding the youth. Mm. I want to ask you a question, but you talk about how you wish you had taken financial literacy a little bit more seriously. One piece of advice to matriculants, grade 11s, high school students, just before they take that leap of faith and decide what they want to study in life, one piece of advice for them?
I think one of the things that I would say is not to be so hard on yourself. Mm. We are not going to have all the answers immediately. One of the things about my personality is that I'm quite the perfectionist. I don't like change.
Okay.
So as soon as something does not align with my plans, I immediately get very uncomfortable. But one thing that I've had to learn is that sometimes life just happens.
Right.
And you cannot control everything. And I'm someone who likes to be in control. I like to be secured. Mm. I like to know what's happening. I like to, you know what to expect. And sometimes life doesn't give us that. But I think one of the main pieces of advice that I would say is not to be so hard on yourself and literally just take life as it goes. There's a saying that says, go with the flow.
Yes.
And a friend of mine brought this up to me in one conversation, and I challenged her and I said, yeah, but dead fish go with the flow. And I'm not a dead fish. So I'm someone who likes to be in charge. I like to take authority. Yeah. I like to be in the moment. I like to, you know, assert myself. Mm. But I've had to take her advice and actually go with the flow because I've seen that's what works better. You know, if you've ever tried to control something, sometimes you'll see it just gets worse.
Mm.
So I think that's really important. And then also take every opportunity that comes by.
Yeah.
I think sometimes we just, if you were to again, the idea of taking a leap of faith, there's a lot of things that I'm even going through at the moment, or decisions I've taken, where I've had to literally take a leap of faith with having no security at all, with not knowing what's coming around the corner.
Mm.
But I would never know the blissful experience I could have if I didn't take.
Exactly.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And if it comes to a place where I've maybe made a wrong decision, it's a lesson that I've learned.
100%.
And I always have this saying where I always tell myself, I don't have any regrets. Mm. I only have lessons learned.
Nice.
And so that's kind of my philosophy as a young person. So I would say to every young person in matric, you know, in a university, don't take life too seriously, but take the opportunities that come, and also don't have any regrets, man.
Mm.
It's just lessons learned. That's all it is.
Yeah. And I have three questions here now, and I'm going to try and ask them. Firstly, I don't know if it was you that posted this, but you talk about going with the flow, and you talk about how fish, whatever, right? But
right.
Someone posted the other day that dead fish still rise to the top.
Wow.
Was it you? No, it wasn't
No, it wasn't me.
Someone posted and they were just like, yeah, cool, you know dead fish float.
Right.
Right, so at the end of the day, yeah, go with the flow, but dead fish still rise to the top. So
that's amazing.
Live a life where that when you leave, your legacy leaves you at the top.
Right. Amazing,
that's
I love that.
Something to
okay.
quote me.
Girl, I'll see you.
I want to talk about, you said you're a perfectionist.
I am.
And that you plan everything strategically.
Right.
Was your home journey, your home buying journey, was it like that? Were you able to... Was everything like pen and everything you wrote, it happened that way?
Absolutely not, anything but. The process itself took about 6 months just to get through all of that.
After finding your perfect home?
The process of finding a home
that would
suit the, you know, affordability and so on. And then also kind of what I was specifically looking for, and we kind of wanted something that suited where we were first at in terms of the, you know, our previous home. And so that was kind of a, and since I am a perfectionist, and since it's my money that I'm investing, I think I have every right to kind of be picky.
Yeah,
you know?
100%.
And a lot of prayer went into it, you know, a lot of talking to God about it. And finally I found a home that I, you know, that we kind of all agreed on and something that I was quite happy with. But that process itself took about 5 to 6 months in terms of just the entire process. Mm-hmm. We actually just got finished about, I would say, a month ago.
Okay.
With the transference and everything. So the house is officially on my name and so on and so
nice.
forth. So that process itself took quite a long time. But in that process, I'm telling you, there was a lot of, it was an uphill battle.
Yeah.
It really isn't, it's not something that just comes like that. You know, obviously if you have the cash and if you, you kind of know someone who knows someone who knows someone, sometimes it's just easier that way. But in my experience, I had an amazing real estate agent.
Okay.
She went above and beyond what she should have.
Yeah.
There were quite a lot of uncertainties, especially from a financial point of view, for me at one point, where it kind of looked, you know, it was kind of like I was a deer in headlights. So I was like, I don't know how am I going to make this one work?
Yeah.
Okay, God, what are you going to do now?
Yeah.
But you know what? Again, leap of faith. I just, there was, you know, when you stress, and you're just like overstressed and you're just like, I'm just gonna chill. I'm just gonna see what God does.
I feel like your home buying journey was one of the biggest things that made you realize you need to go with the flow.
Oh, that couldn't be like more than the truth, honestly.
Yeah.
It really was. I think that process itself actually grew me as a person, you know? But yeah, it was definitely an uphill battle. It was not easy, but it's so worth it at the end, honestly, so worth it.
Right, yeah. And you know, you talk about how you did this for your parents and, you know, leaving the legacy. What was your biggest reason for actually like investing in property? Was it for your parents, or like, was there more reasons behind investing in property?
I think there's so many answers to that. I don't think I can give you a straightforward answer.
We have time.
I mean,
lots of time. Yeah.
I think what influenced it a lot was because I have such a go-getter attitude, and me wanting to kind of just make, not make a name of myself, but yeah, make a name for myself, myself.
Yeah.
I wanted to be a young person, you know, that bought a home. You know, that is what we talk about on social media. That is what I see on my newsfeed every day. Just the other day, I saw a quote that says, we are grinding to buy property, not designer.
Yes.
And so that's something that really speaks to me. It makes an impact on me because I want to be able to do things that set me up for the future.
Right.
And because I'm someone that thinks very long term, I'm not someone that thinks for just now.
Yeah.
I'm always someone who thinks, you know, what is this going to give me in the next 10 years? What is this going to be like in the next 5 years? And that's how I kind of plan. You know, that's how I make all my decisions. And so I knew that even though financially buying this home would probably be the biggest, you know, one of the best decisions I could ever make, but also one of the most challenging decisions I could ever make, I always keep in mind that this is the best decision for the long term.
Right.
So I know that one day, you know, when I'm settled and all of those things, I don't have to worry about that. I can spend my money now and design the things if I want to do, because I've got the property.
Exactly. Now you can.
Right. And so now when I got to work and my colleagues, you know, kind of knew now that I bought the property. So I made this remark to a colleague of mine, and I said, first we own the house, then we own the block. So that's kind of where I'm moving forward to at the moment.
I don't want to name drop, but there are these two famous celebrities, I don't know if you heard the story, where she was looking to, so they got divorced,
right?
And then you'll probably get who it is, but I just can't name drop on the show. And then they were married, they're now divorced with like 5 kids, and then he moved out, and he was like, but he bought the house,
right?
And he was like, I want my house. And she was like, the land is mine.
Shoo. Oh, I love it. I love it.
And I feel like these are the goals that we need to have in life, right? You're so right. I feel like investing in property, because you think long term.
Right.
And that's something that I feel a lot of young people should kind of invest in, is to think about their long term goals, not only with property, but with their life, what they decide to study. In the spirit of, by the time this airs, it's probably July, but in the spirit of Youth Month, that's something that I think should be generated. These thoughts should be, you know, spoken amongst the youth. And you're 24 and you're talking about like these quotes, and you're dropping these quotes, and you're talking about the conversations you have with your friends, who I assume are also your age.
Right.
And 24 for me is a very young, although we're like 3 years apart, but still, I just feel like if I had these chats at this age or even before, that a lot of things could shift. And like you said, the only thing now is to go forward. You're 24, but actually, let me ask you this question. You bought your first home.
I did.
What does your property portfolio, what does your property journey look like going forward? Is this, or do you want to become like a property investor?
I would love to.
Mm-hmm.
I would absolutely love to. At the moment, it's not something that I'm seriously considering at the moment, But mentally, I'm actually looking at buying my own apartment. So I would love a penthouse apartment, and I would love to invest in property to kind of open up another avenue of income as well. That's why I speak about financial stability.
Right.
And the way to kind of open that up is, you know, to create different avenues of income. So definitely my property journey hasn't ended here. I think it's just begun. Definitely.
Yeah.
But I think I'm off to a good start though.
100%.
Yes, I am.
You have a home. But 100%. You know,
now that you brought up youth month and all of that, I think especially as a woman, you know, women always talk about how we got to have our own, we've got to have our own back, and we've got to look after ourselves, and this idea of self-love, and you know, ain't no man going to tell me. And,
yeah.
You know, we always have this mindset. And so what I really want to also bring across is it's not just about putting a Facebook post out there.
Yeah.
It's also about taking the action towards that. Mm-hmm. And so now I can literally say, no, I have my own.
Yeah.
No.
Okay.
No.
As she fixes a jacket,
a
designer jacket.
I have my own.
Yeah.
So I think that's really important, is that as women, we really do look after ourselves.
Mm.
You know, there's also this idea of taxi queens and, you know, always wanting that a guy to kind of take care of you and,
right.
and doing those things. And I think what's really important to me is that I have my own independence.
Mm-hmm.
And I think if you are going to put any expectation on someone else, there should be something that you're bringing to the table.
100%.
So if I'm expecting my partner to have this amazing mansion, I should also be able to
say,
kind of,
I have,
you know,
my, yeah.
Come on, like there should be that equality.
Exactly.
And so buying the house actually meant quite a bit, you know, that idea of kind of, you know, looking after myself, being independent, you know, just the idea of general relationships and looking after family and, you know, being able to be an example. I know that to a lot of friends, this is quite a big deal to them as well, because one of them has now made it kind of on top to them.
Okay.
So I'm really happy that I'm able to inspire them that way and to motivate them that way.
Exactly.
I've actually received quite a bit of other young people in my age bracket who are now asking me advice on what I did and how I did it and all these amazing things. So I can definitely see that buying this house was not just about me.
Yeah.
Again, that idea of mindfulness, there was a lot of other people that were affected by this.
Exactly.
And so that's what I love the most about it. So this will definitely, I definitely will buy other property,
yeah.
but this will always be a special one for
100, because it taught you so much.
Right.
And we just spoke about this actually a few weeks ago, the ecosystem.
Mm.
It's this thing that continues. You did it for yourself, but you taught so many other people around you.
Yes.
And they're going to go do the same for other people. And ecosystem, and that's how I feel that we should be, not only in our friend circles, in our family circles, I mean, you have your own business, and you said, some of the bulk of the support came from people, strangers you didn't know.
Yeah.
Those strangers today can still come to you and be like, what was it like buying your first home?
Yes.
They can watch the show and be educated by the knowledge that you had to. It's, you know, I truly live by the saying that real lived experiences teach us the most.
Right.
And you've lived that journey. Of course you had an agent, a friend, or advice from the internet. These things help us, but you still had to go through the process to actually know what that was like. So just before you know, we wrap up the show, I want to ask you about, what was there one thing you wish you had known? Maybe not one thing. Is there something you wish you knew before you bought your home?
I think maybe just the process, the duration of the process. I think in particular the transfer fees, that was something that I genuinely was not prepared for. So obviously the transfer fees is now when the house officially becomes you know, mine in terms of name, and so you have to pay for that.
Mm-hmm.
And so one of the things that I learned was that the transfer fees depend on how expensive the house is.
Yes. We learned this the hard way, Sherith. We really
I really did. I learned that the hard way. And so I think that's something I would have wanted to really know about beforehand, you know, kind of getting into the process. And by the time I was, that was kind of brought to my attention, it was kind of too late.
Yeah.
So again, like I said, I was like a deer in headlights.
Yeah.
I didn't know what to do.
Yeah.
But you know what? Again, life just has a habit of being bittersweet.
Mm-hmm.
And somehow things just kind of, you know, right time, right space, right people.
Mm-hmm.
And really, I can honestly say that I could not have bought this house on my own. There's no way.
Mm.
There was definitely divine intervention that I give absolute onus to when it comes to that. And so, yeah, that's basically my experience.
Sorry, I'm just... I'm a deer in headlights right now, because that's so powerful for me, you know, and I feel like there's a lot of things. Yes, you have support on this realm, on this level, but there is there's more support, right. You know, whoever you believe in, whatever the case may be. But I do want to ask you, so do you have any regrets, Sherith?
No.
None whatsoever.
None whatsoever. I am so over the moon. I get to literally get home and then like turn the key to my own house.
Mm.
And that is so incredible to me.
Mm.
And you know what? It's such a humbling experience. There's not one part of me that feels arrogant about it.
Yeah.
There isn't even some sort of ego response to it. It's literally such a humble experience because I realize that as quick as it was given to me, it can also be taken
100%.
Away. And so right now in the space that I'm in, now that I have the house, I believe it's my responsibility to now protect what I have because there was divine intervention.
Mm.
And so it's not something that I take lightly, but it's a responsibility that I now have on my shoulders. And yes, challenging, but I gladly take it on my shoulders.
100%.
Because I believe it was given to me because I can handle it.
And you've been given the strength to handle it right now.
Right.
You know, so there's no regrets, and I love that. I think that this is a humbling experience for everyone, anyone who has bought their first home. And just before we close up, you said no regrets, and you said that you need the strength to, you know, carry this achievement. But what would you say keeps you motivated every day?
Oh, see, you always ask me questions that have multiple answers.
We have time now.
Look, I think there's so many things. I always believe that I live a life of complete purpose. So when I get up in the morning, I have purpose. There's a reason why I get up.
Yeah.
And it's not limited to the fact that I'm a teacher. You know, it's bigger than that. It's the fact that, like I said earlier to you, I owe everything to divine intervention. So mm-hmm. I know that there is a plan for my life and that I've been set apart for something completely different. So I know that there is purpose to what I'm doing and why I get up in the mornings. That's my first motivation.
Mm-hmm.
My second motivation is that I have about 500 kids who are under my wing.
Yeah.
So every morning I get up literally because of them.
Yes. Can't drop the ball.
You know what I believe very strongly is that leadership cannot be taught.
Mm.
Leadership has to be caught. And one of the things
caught?
Yes. And one of the things that, and I'll explain why.
Yeah.
A leader is not defined by, oh, I can manage this really well, or I've got this on my CV, I did this.
Yeah.
Oh, I can delegate really well. A leader is defined by influence.
Mm.
And we all have influence. As we are sitting here right now, each person has influence.
Mm-hmm.
And so, as a teacher, as a leader in my classroom, as a colleague, as a friend, as a role model, I have influence.
Mm.
So, anytime you have influence, you are able to, you know, impact people with the decisions that you make. So, every time I go to my class, I know that I'm influencing these kids.
Yeah.
And one thing that I've learned about the kids is that you need to earn their respect. And one of the things that I've learned is that you have to have credibility in order for them to respect you.
Right.
And I'm gonna land this play now with what I'm getting to. Is that we teachers have the tendency to always wanna give advice and you mustn't do this and you mustn't do that and you've gotta live a life like this. But we don't show those kids how to do it. So if I'm preaching to my kids about financial stability, I need to give an example of in my own life of my financial stability. So they know that Ms. Whaley has bought a home.
Yeah.
But what has that influenced them to do?
Yeah.
Now they know Ms. Whaley, you know, is financially stable. I need to do the same thing because I can also buy a house.
Exactly.
And so that is the way in which I create credibility with them to the point where they actually want to listen to what I have to say.
Yeah.
And what teachers tend to do is we tend to kind of say things that we know that we think the kids want to listen to.
Yeah.
But I just have a different kind of way that I deal with the learners. Mm-hmm. And that's definitely one of the things that motivate me is the fact that I know that I have influence over them and I want to be able to use that for good.
Mm-hmm.
The goal is always to see them better than me.
Of course.
You know, so if I can create little mini-me's but better than me, I'd be so happy.
And it's not only about breaking the generational curses within your own family tree.
Right.
It's about helping those, you know. And
exactly.
Again, it goes back to real lived experiences.
Right.
You need to live it in order to teach it.
Right.
I never call myself a teacher. I call myself a facilitator because I believe that people come to the space with their own level of education.
Right.
I facilitate your thinking. I facilitate.
Right.
I guide. Meet them where they are and then take it from there. And I think just before we wrap up now, I wanted to ask you, you've already, you know, shared with us how you would teach financial literacy to the kids that you teach on the daily basis. But I want you to leave us with something you know, just like words of inspiration. You're a really good speaker, and I love that about you, because you come with all these quotes, and I like that. So I want you to leave the youth, and let's take it, because I want to reiterate the fact that you are juggling so much. Mm. You are still doing your honors.
I am.
You sit in class doing your own personal assignments while the kids are... Am I allowed to say this on
camera? No, of course you can.
While the kids, you know, they're busy with the exams right now. We're right. In that phase, and... You know, Shirith is sitting in class juggling her own assignments while they're busy doing their assessments. And I mean, you're always posting about your property goals. You're always posting about dream. The other day you post like an entire thread of your dream homes.
Yeah. One of them is 27 million, by the way.
Well, there you go. Let's just wait for Shirith to get that 27 mil house. I mean, hello.
We can do the interview in that house.
We can. We're definitely going to do our next interview there. You know, because that's about manifesting. It's about having these goals and this vision. And so, yes, I'd like you to leave us with something extremely, like leave us with a few words of, so what does Shirith do to get out of that space of just, you're just feeling overwhelmed and you just want to move on?
Let me start off by saying that being busy and being a perfectionist is too, like, you don't want to be a perfectionist and busy at the same time. Mm. So at the moment in my life, sometimes, because I am a perfectionist, but I'm so busy at the same time, like I've said to you, life just kind of throws things at you that you cannot control. Mm. And so that creates a lot of frustration for me. So there are moments where I feel very demotivated, where I feel like I can't carry on anymore. I just feel so drained emotionally, mentally, physically. Mm. You must remember that not only am I studying, you know, I'm working, I've got the business, started my own foundation, I'm also a friend.
Yeah.
You know, I'm also a colleague. I play all these different roles, and all of these roles have different expectations.
100%.
So as a human being, we deal with so many expectations, and sometimes it's hard to come by. Mm. It's hard for you to be able to live up to those expectations. Mm. But as I said earlier, it's so important that you don't take life too seriously. We don't all have the answers at all times. And so currently in my life, and I don't know what life holds, nothing is guaranteed in life, I believe. But what I do know is this, and currently in my life, is that it's so important to give yourself a break. Mm. There are times where I genuinely feel so drained when I get home. I genuinely just want to jump out the car and just get into bed. And there are days where I literally just get home and I get into bed. I have an exam paper due, I have marking due, I have reports due. I've got to do something at home, maybe I have an extramural activity. I've got to do this, I've got to go to that meeting, I've got to fulfill that responsibility. Oh yes, I promised a learner I was going to help. So there's so many things, and when I get into those moments, I just need to have some time to myself.
Yeah.
So what I do is actually, funny enough, I start listening to white noise. I know that white noise is actually used for babies.
Yeah.
But I actually listen to it and it literally calms me down. Or like raindrops or something, it literally calms me down so much. So usually what I do is when I get home, I take 2 hours for myself.
Oh wow.
No one, I don't talk to anybody.
Yeah.
I kind of just Netflix and
chill.
That's literally
proper,
what I do.
Yeah.
Snacks is also my best friend. I love doing that, but it literally relaxes my mind.
Yeah.
I also try to work kind of in the evenings. And the reason why I do that is because no one's awake.
Right.
And no one has expectations of me. So I can focus that way a lot easier. Mm. But that's just kind of like practical steps.
What you do,
But I would say just take a break when you need to. Mm. You know, mental health is a serious element that we're kind of dealing with.
And reaching the point of like breaking down and like is so real.
Right.
We reach those points very quickly, and if we don't take those moments, you know, we can just fail, and we don't want the system to fail.
Of course.
We want to continue.
Yes.
And I want to thank you. Firstly, I want to say congratulations. This is a recent. Yes. This is a recent thing, you know, just before your birthday, you got it, you know. It's absolutely amazing. Congratulations.
Thank you so much. I appreciate it.
You know, and I just, you know, I wish you the best with your property journey going forth. I honestly do. And what was it, 26 million?
The Dream House.
The Dream House, 26
that's
million.
That's my vision board at the moment.
So that's where we'll see you.
Exactly.
We need to put a time frame on that. When can we come?
You know, in my life, things just happen like this.
Come on.
So I can't put a time limit to it, but let me tell you, it will be soon.
It's going to be soon.
It will be soon.
And we're going to see you
Let me tell you something. Mm-hmm. Mark this day. Today is the 24th. Mm-hmm. By the time I am 35, I'll be done paying off that house.
Amen.
Absolutely.
That
I
is,
believe it.
Again, manifesting, saying, stating these things, putting it out into the universe. Yeah. That's what we need. That's the energy we need going forward. And that's to everyone at home as well. Thank you so much, Shereth, again.
Thank you so
much. Really appreciate you taking out the time. As I said, we are at Saxonburg Wine Farm. We've had amazing food, had a great time at this wine farm. So do, if you're coming to Cape Town, head on over here. The food is great. Everything is great. To Shereth Whaley, thank you so much. Teacher, educator, facilitator, manifesting greatness in life. She's also doing our honors, everything. The plate is full, but she's juggling it, and we're eating good because she is. Plate is full, but we're eating. So thank you so much to everyone who's tuned in this evening. I've been Estee Klassen, and this is the First Time Home Buyer Show. Go well, take care, and stay warm.